88.1 WHPR. This is the Rerun Detroit Boxing Show. I got some special guests in today, man. Two special guests. And we also got, one of them also brought one of the top amateurs in Michigan. We go Detroit, Michigan, as well. Well, Michigan overall. So we going to, today, y'all, I got my man, one of the Kronk legends, my man, IBL champion, Jimmy Paul. What's up?
All right. Everything going well.
And I got my man. My man, Erskine Doug Wade. What's up, Erskine?
What's happening, baby? Everything good?
And tell us about your fighter right there on the left side.
Oh, man, I brought this devastating kid with me. His name is Jair Thompson. He just came out the Olympic trials, and he, lost in the quarterfinals, but a terrific fighter, outstanding. He does a lot of things for the community, and he's just a great guy all the way around. So... there we have it.
My man Jabu, what's up, man?
It's Jabu the Great. That's what I'm known as, Jabu the Great, Jair Thompson.
So, whatever you want to call him. Man, for the people out there that's listening to this radio show, you guys, I got to start with you, the ringmaster.
That's right.
I know you and Doug got some great history for us. Tell us, what's the difference between boxing then and boxing now?
I think it's just like the world, really. Mm-hmm. Like food and everything is kind of watered down. Mm-hmm. And it's very hard to get good fighters now. I mean, real good seasoned fighters, because they don't get a chance to really see the boxing that we used to see and the art of it years ago. Years ago, you was considered red hot if you won the Golden Gloves back in that era. Mm-hmm. And I just think a lot of people not taking up boxing as it used to. When they used to take up boxing a lot, it meant it was so many people in the arena, and you got to fight all these different fights, which gave you more experience. So now, by being less boxers, you don't get that much experience because you don't have that much work. And mostly everybody in our era, they all had 100 fights before turning professional.
Okay.
Now these guys turning pro with 20 fights.
Okay.
But it's a few good ones in here that I really like it, really like watching.
Okay. So, Doug, what was the most funnest thing about boxing back in your day, back in your time?
Well, back then, we trained hard. We trained to make ourselves out of great fighters and great people and things like that. And the thing about it was we trained. We didn't have to have a coach standing over us, telling us how to throw a 1-2, or telling us to jump rope, or telling us to do calisthenics. We trained. We ran. We did this. We did that. It wasn't about partners. It wasn't about just hitting the streets. It was about developing and becoming something great.
Okay.
Outside the ring and inside the ring.
Yeah.
Okay. So take us back then, Erskine. Like, tell us, what would you say was your hardest? Out of all the fights you had, what was your hardest fight?
My hardest fight was against a kid named Orlando Johnson from Chicago, Illinois. I'll never forget it. I kept seeing him in the ring. I was in ring two and he was in ring one. Mm-hmm. And every time I look over to ring one, he was knocking his opponent out. And so I met him in the semifinals, and of course he ended up beating me. But that was the hardest fight because I had to really put out for that fight and, put my experience and show that I am a part of the amateur program, whereas I'm unique. And so therefore, but it was a good fight. And then later on in life, I got him back. So I won in AU.
You got that get back.
Yeah, but it still was a tough fight.
So give us a day in the life of the training camp, Jimmy. How was training camp for Jimmy Paul?
Well, training camp was actually at home for me as well. Mm-hmm. I would go to bed at night. My mother and father, they would be up maybe around 11 o'clock at night, say, hey, you can't burn the candle on both ends, when I first turned professional. And after a while, I got used to it. I said, well, if you're going to be champion of the world, you got to do stuff that other fighters won't do. You got to go to bed at night. You got to eat right. You got to rest right. You can't be all outside all through the hours of night. And that was part of it. And I also ran a lot by myself, and I trained extra harder than most of the fighters in the gym.
So what time would y'all train in the morning? Duck, what time would y'all get up and train in the morning?
Well, my morning was like at 6 in the morning. I'm up running.
Dang, you ran at 6 in the morning?
6, sometime 5. I mean, I got up and did my thing because I love the boxing. Mm-hmm. And who inspired me to be a fighter? It wasn't Tommy Hearns. It was Muhammad Ali. I had a style, something like his, similar to his. And he inspired me to, you know, be a great fighter. And that's what I wanted to be, a great fighter. And to me, I thought I was. And I still believe that I am, you know. So I got up, I ran, I watched what I ate. I didn't drink pop, I didn't drink, eat chips, I didn't eat candy. I was all in, 100% all in. I did everything I thought that I could do to be a champion. I didn't have no letdowns. I was a state champion, featherweight and junior lightweight champion in Michigan. And also, I fought a lot of guys that was bigger than me. I was really a fighter. I mean, you know, it was like, I'm going to box this guy. I'm going to fight this guy. He's going to 135. You only 125. I said, well, I'll take the fight. Just give it to me. I wanted to please the crowd. I wanted to be that guy.
Okay. Okay. So, Jimmy.
Yes.
How was it? Like, I know, you know, everybody won the IBF title. So, give us the time. You trained in the, you ran in the morning, right?
Yeah, of course. You got to get up and run early, 5 or 6 o'clock in the morning.
Now, is it true that all y'all stay close to each other? You, Mill, did everybody stay close, like, near each other?
Yes, we all did. There's a bunch of us stay, even to this day. I was going to mention something that Duck was talking about earlier about who inspired him was Muhammad Ali.
Okay.
And one day, I woke up and I told my mother, Muhammad Ali is coming over to the house today. Mm-hmm. And she looked at me like I was crazy, and I went outside on the block telling the people on the block that Muhammad Ali is going to show up in probably an hour.
Okay.
An hour went by, and Muhammad Ali pulls up, and they all looking like, oh my goodness, they just swamped the street. Probably about 300 people out there in no time. And that was a real, real good experience for me. And back to your other question that you was asking me. Prior to this.
Yeah, so when, like, you ran in the morning.
Yep.
So when you, did y'all, because I know Kronk was a recreation, did y'all train at night? Because I know, what time did Kronk open and what time did it close?
Normally they'll get there, some people get there about 12 o'clock.
Oh, okay.
You know,
okay.
When we start, after a while, I wanted to kind of do a lot of stuff alone, but okay. I would hold out of guys in the gym. Because
okay.
Kronk always so hot and sweating, it's probably, like, about 100 guys in there. And you're waiting on the bag, and when you they finally get on the bag, it wasn't but a couple of heavy bags, you got to call your bag probably about 10 people in front of you before you can get to it. So we was working through that kind of stuff. And after a while, I ran into a good friend of mine in school, and he started calling and setting up all my, which name was Stan Weaver. He started setting all my workouts up and bags and everything. I really, really liked it. That.
Take us out to this story, man. What happened between you and Hector Camacho, man?
Nothing really, you know, we boxed. I shouldn't have boxed him. One time I came to the Kronk and he had blood on his chest in the ring walking around like he running the gym. And everybody in the gym was looking like, oh, I got somebody you can't beat. I had just walked in the door. So okay. Now Tommy and all of them talking to him, telling me that he can't do this and that with me. And next thing I know, I boxed him. I should have let him beat me up. My father told me that when I got home. He said, son, you should never beat him up. If you beat him up, he ain't gonna give you the fight. And he was right. We had there a $1 million fight, and I couldn't even get the fight because I had boxed him and kind of got the best of him in the gym, and he just never took that fight. And then later on, I ended up with the title, so now he can make even more money now fighting me with a belt, too. He wouldn't do it. And that happened to me with a lot of fighters, to be honest with you. I couldn't get a fight with Ray Mancini. I couldn't get a fight with Livingston Bramble. I asked them guys personally to give me a fight. This is why I got the title. I couldn't get it. Me and Manuel Stewart was on the phone while Edwin Rosario was fighting somebody, and we talked about it. Manuel said, Jimmy, if he win the fight, you fighting him next.
So Doug,
that didn't happen.
You and Jimmy, y'all sparred before, or y'all was doing different weight class?
No, we was, Jimmy was a featherweight, and I was a featherweight, but we never sparred.
Never sparred.
And that
never.
Was so weird that
it
man
was.
That was boxing.
It was weird. Because we was at the same gym doing the same
every
thing.
Every day and never boxed.
So who did you box a lot to get ready for fights in Erskine?
I boxed Milton McCoy. I boxed...
Mill was that small back then?
No, Mill was 130. Mill took it. You know, he worked with me. He's a welterweight.
Okay.
I boxed J.L. Ivey. I boxed a whole bunch of guys. The Johnson brothers. There was nobody that I wouldn't box. I boxed everybody. But I just, me and Jim never, Hurley Sneed, I boxed. Me and Jimmy never just, we never ran into each other. You know, we talked, whatever, high, bye, and that's it. We never looked at each other down or up or whatever. You know what I mean? And then when I seen Jimmy fight Gary Martin, and then I say.
We got a caller.
Okay.
Come on. Caller, you on the air?
Hello?
Yeah, we on here now.
Yeah,
that's his phone.
Yeah.
Yeah, call back.
So, yeah, you know, I trained with a lot of different guys. I just want to be – I went to a lot of different gyms. I did this, I did that. But my whole thing was to be a good fighter. Mm-hmm. And I was watching Jimmy and them coming up, doing their thing, and Milton and everybody. I just picked up a lot of little things from here and there and there and here. And that's what made me as good as I was.
Okay, okay. So, Jabu, we ain't going to let you just be over there and be quiet. Jabu, what's the funnest thing you like about boxing?
Man, just the competitiveness of the sport and being able to display my talent at all times, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Really, I'm just striving to be the best. And until then, I don't feel like I'm done with my career. So, you know. Oh, another fun thing, I like traveling everywhere. I've been to almost all 50 states.
Wow.
Just off boxing, just off my talent.
Yeah. Okay. Now, yeah. Jimmy, and Doug, give us, how was it for y'all in the Nationals back in the day?
I like what he said. A lot of the stuff that this young man was talking about was exciting to me, to travel all the time. You going all kind of places you never thought you would be going to go. And that was a major role in it. And we outside us traveling all the time. We, of course, a lot of times you got to go in, you got to sleep good, you got to rest good, you're out of town. You can't do what the other fighters are doing because you want to win it. You want to be in the championship. And normally in the championship, you fighting five or six times to win the whole entire tournament, so you got to consistently go eat and go to bed like you ain't out of town.
Exactly. Yeah. Well, myself, you know, I train, like I said, very hard, to the extreme. You know, when I'm getting ready for the Golden Gloves, I'm training for the National Golden Gloves, not just for the state, because I know I'm going to win the state. You know, that's up here.
How many times did you win the Detroit Golden Glove?
Oh, man, about eight times.
Dang.
About eight times. Semifinals in the National Golden Gloves, finals in the National AU, and I won the National Pell Tournament, and then I lost the National Pell Tournament so in the finals. So I had a good career. I had a real good career. I mean,
Jimmy, did you go to the Olympic trials?
You know what? They boycotted the Olympics. In 1980, I was the number one contender, and I boxed this guy that was the number two contender, which the guy that beat, first guy that beat Julio Cesar Chavez. Frankie Randall.
Randall, yeah.
So I came to the gym and boxed him. I boxed him, and I think he passed now. Anyway,
he did.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah.
Yep.
And I boxed him. I said, "Well, he's the number one guy or number two guy. I'm going to the Olympics." And I was so hurt about it. It was boycotted. And the other guy that went, who was that? Jerry Page.
Yeah, Jerry Page.
Jerry Page went to, but that was 84. Jerry Page ended up going with Steve McCroy and them in 84. But I thought for sure I would make the Olympic team.
Mm.
He had all the abilities to do it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, what would you say, I know back then Milton went and Steven went too, right? Steve McCroy.
Well, Steve McCroy did.
Steve went and Milton.
Milton did go, okay.
No.
Okay, so who all went from here? Him?
No, it was Frank Tate.
Yeah, Frank
Thomas Tate was there, too.
Ricky Womack,
okay.
And,
Because y'all had some killers over there.
Well, yeah, we ended up with Parnell Whitaker in the gym and Mark Breland.
You know what?
And Kronk just exploded after a while.
Right, because I stayed across the street from a guy named Rick Juster.
Yeah
Rock and Sock him. Rick Juster.
Yeah, he's called the Monk, because he's a monkey.
Yeah.
Yeah, they say he won the national with six fights.
You know what? He was a rough guy. He was strong. And
he could fight.
And he ended up, that's shocking for a guy to be in the finals like that with those little bit of fights. You know, it's unheard of, but he was so strong and powerful and throw his punches so straight and accurate. He was knocking guys out.
Yes, sir.
Did you get a chance to spar Hector Camacho?
Yeah, man, I went to camp to Hector so many times. Jimmy just was saying, I first sparred him down at Kronk's, and yeah, I'm not going to lie to you, he got off on me that day. But I made it to myself to say, hey, I got to make this up. So I went to camp with him for about six times, and I showed him up a bit or two, you know what I mean?
So you was able to get back.
Yeah, I got to get back. But Hector was a good fighter. I'm not going to lie, he was a good fighter. He showed me a couple of things. He taught me a few things, you know what I mean? My quest was to try to be a world champion, and how you get there by boxing with world champions.
Was you ever offered a fight or no?
To Hector? Nah.
Because you was in camp with him?
Yeah. I mean, not just that. It just never came about. I was offered a fight with Zuma Nelson at one time when I was his sparring partner.
Really?
Yeah, at Don King training camp.
Yeah, I heard about him.
Yes, sir.
So if you had a chance to fight again, if you had a chance to fight again back in your day, who would you have liked to fight, Jimmy?
Like the fighters
just
I
Hector?
Named.
Just Hector?
No, Hector, Ray Mancini, Livingston Bramble. Quite a few of them. I would love to get those guys that won the title, but like I said, I could never get those title fights.
What about you, Erskine?
Oh, man. Juan Laporte.
Why him?
Because they called me for a fight, and when I got to the airport, they canceled the fight. Because I was at camp with Johnny De La Rosa in Puerto Rico, and they seen me boxing with Johnny. And I guess I was going to be some bit of a problem. I don't know. I don't know why they called it that. I was at the airport, getting ready to board the plane, and they called and said they're canceling the fight. And it hurt me so bad.
You was on the plane?
No, I wasn't on it. I was at the ticket place, you know, I get my tickets and everything.
Counter, yeah.
Yeah. And then they called and said, well, the fight been canceled. They said Juan got hurt, but he didn't get hurt. There's no day they see me down there with Johnny De La Rosa, his spine partner. I was working out with him down there. So that was like a whole 3 weeks. And they knew it wasn't going to be as easy as they thought.
Oh, hold on, y'all. We got a call. Let me see if I can get the phone line. Hold on a second. Call you on the air. Hold on a second.
The gentleman in the all black, he made a statement, and I want to see if I can get an answer from him. And also the young man that's on the panel in all the blue, the young man in all black.
Okay.
Let's say this. He said that fighting is watered down now. Can he give me an example what he considers watered down with the fighting they're doing now? And would he make it in the fighting now?
She says watered. You said it was watered down.
Yeah, what do you mean by that?
Well, yeah, what I mean is, like, back in the day, we would have to rent Cobo Hall out to have the Golden Glove because there was so many people coming to see fights, probably about 10,000 people showing up at a Golden Glove Nationals. Nowadays, you go to a show and you may have 300 people for one. And then you had so many boxers boxing back in that era that you got a lot of experience because you had to fight two or three times just to leave the city. Now, you may get a bye to the national, and sometimes you get down there, you may not have but one or two fights then. So exactly. That's the difference. You just had got more experience. Like I said, everybody had over 100 amateur fights. And now, these guys, they turn pro with 20 fights because, like I said, it's not a lot of boxing like it used to be.
Oh, they done hung up now.
Oh. No,
she's still there? You still there? Okay.
Well, yeah. That's so the down there. You're talking about the semantics of boxing and not necessarily the physical part of it. Because I still see 20 years ago how you're in the ring and you're still going at each other. That's still happening today. But you're talking pretty much so of the structure of boxing and not necessarily the physical part of boxing is watered down.
You
correct?
Are right. You know, you also need better trainers. They used to have better trainers back then. That way you can really teach the art of boxing. But, you know, now most guys are getting in shape off lifting weights and exercise and building their body up, but not the talent and the experience. When to tie up, when to walk away from the referee, turn your back, go behind the referee so you can get some extra rest. A lot of little small things that I used to see, I don't see it no more. I went to the Golden Glove Nationals in 1976, and I saw loads of experience. Sugar Ray Leonard pulled out the tournament in 76. And the reason why, he knew this other guy was probably going to end up winning the fight because something wasn't always right with him. And 3 months later, he was a total different body. He went somewhere and trained his butt off. And he came here to Detroit to fight in the box off.
Yep.
And he ended up winning. But whatever he went and did, he came back a different fighter because down there, he was on the bus. He was riding back to the hotel. He was kind of busted all up. So I thought maybe he should have pulled out the tournament as well, and he did.
Now, the young man there, now, I wonder if he can answer this. Does he feel boxing is watered down the way that you expressed it? I just want to know if he is feeling the same thing. I see it being the same. I really do. The conditioning, becoming a boxer is different. I used to think, and I still want the young man to respond. I used to think that Mike Tyson, because we didn't see him in the ring long enough. Him knocking somebody out in 40 seconds or a minute and whatever, that wasn't really boxing to me, but the power behind him and the skill set, if you didn't have to be there 10 rounds or 8 rounds or even 3 rounds, if you can get it over, get it over.
Okay, so for your answer, I'll, yes. be, only feel that it's watered down only from what I heard. From every story I heard, it was way more people that was supporting boxing, and boxing was way bigger. You know, now everybody's just doing it to have fun. I can tell. Like, even when people come into the gym, they don't train as hard as the old school boxers used to. So, basically, like, you have to put your mindset at a different standard than you would have had to.
Okay.
Well, let me, if you don't mind, let me end for a minute. To me, what Mr. Paul was saying, and the young man, because the young man wouldn't know because he haven't been around, but from the trainers that have been training him to teach him, he see that it's a different from when he first came in, because we're doing the old-style training. The fighters today are not the same as the fighters when we was coming up. Just like when we was coming up, the fighters that were before us, Ali, Joe Frazier, they're different. Every fighter changes up after maybe about 10 years of the sports changes. I feel like this here. Yeah, you got some great fighters out here right now, this and that and whatever. But to go back to saying, if we go back to Joe Frazier and Muhammad Ali, you know, they were great, great, great fighters. You know, these fighters today, and when we was coming up, we was good fighters. But to me, they were great fighters. And these fighters today, they don't train, they don't put out like we do. You don't have to tell us to come in when we come in the gym how to work out. We know what to do. We doing it all day long. Fit 5 rounds, 10 rounds, hit the bag, jump rope, exercise, this, that, and whatever. This is what makes a difference between the fighters of yesteryear and today's fighter.
I understand that. I think the skill set is better. I think the skill set, it was more, and I don't want to say savage like maybe 25, 30 years ago, but now it's more skill set. I don't know. I just personally, I don't think it's watered down. And the same thing, you can go with the NBA. Like now, a lot of three pointers and the guys play a little different. I think NBA is watered down now because of how they used to play 20 years ago and 30 years ago. It's totally different now. Yeah. Even the rules are totally different. I just think boxing is much more physical, and your conditioning.
Yeah, everything changes. I mean, look at the football players. You can't even hit the quarterback no more. Everything changes.
Correct.
For the safety of the fighters. Like now, the amateurs, the amateur boxer from the USA, they got so many different rules now with the boxing, the fouls, and et cetera, et cetera. So things have changed. And it is to protect us. So I really appreciate what they're doing. For the football, basketball, whatever. In boxing also, it changes. You know, I don't want to see my friend not able to talk or can't see or whatever. If it's about just stopping the fight early, fine. You get to live another day.
Understood, and I truly thank you guys for that. This is very rewarding. Our young boys, our young men need this, and you're taking the role of teaching them. I would have to say it's a brutal sport, and it's very physical. Yes, you don't need to be killed in the ring, or you don't need to have major conditions after the ring. I do get it. It's the skill set right now. But I thank you. I thank you guys, and I appreciate you, Kings.
All right. Thank you for calling in, Carlton, okay?
Thank you.
Thank you for calling in, okay?
Yeah, right.
I understand what you're saying, though. Like, it is definitely more flashy now. I can say it's more flashy. Like, even, like,
tall they do a whole
back, talk. Back in the day, yeah.
Oh, we got another caller. Caller, you on the air.
Hello?
Caller, you on the air.
I'd like to make a comment about the condition of the boxers, the way the boxers are now. The old school boxers were more, I guess, famous or active outside the ring. You got to be good outside the ring as well as inside the ring. You got to have a personality. That would make them a difference in the difference of the boxing eras, to me.
Okay. And may I ask who's calling in?
Oh, this is Terry. This is Terry. Coach Terry from the Kronk boxing team.
Okay. Okay. Right. Okay, that's what's up, man. Thank you for calling in, okay? Hello?
They just be on.
It'd be so excited. Man, we got so many phone calls, man. The number is 313-868-0331. Again, the number is 313-868-0331. This is the Rerun Detroit Boxing Show, man. I got two legends in the house, man. One is a IBF champion. The other was a Michigan State champion. But he been around, man. These guys been around. They know boxing. And they boxing. Then you got another guy over here, man. He's one of the top amateurs in Michigan, my man Jabu. That's right. So don't sleep on him. Now, Doug.
Yes, sir. Speak it to me.
I got some questions for you, man.
I was waiting on
that. I got some great questions for you. Well, everybody want to know about this story. And I'm not trying to start nothing, but I'm going to say it. You and Greg Cumberson.
That's right. Let's speak it.
How did that go? How did this sparring session go?
Oh, man. It was a beautiful thing. His manager name is Billy Gooch, and he had seen me down at the gym working out.
Okay.
And he wanted to bring me down to the powerhouse here in Highland Park. And I came down, and he had me to box with Greg Coverson.
Okay.
He was supposed to do 5 rounds, but he ended up just being 2 rounds.
Oh, wow.
And he got out the ring, and I was like, what happened? What did he stop for? And they never was able to tell me why he stopped.
Okay.
So right now today, Greg always tells a different story.
Well, we're going to leave it at that.
He tells a different story that I get out the ring. Hey. But no, he got out the ring, and there was a thing that I understood the reason why.
Well, we're going to leave it at that. We're going to leave it at that. So, Jimmy.
Yeah.
Who was one of your main sparring partners to get ready for your fights? At Kronk.
Actually, what I would do, you know, I come off from being off out of training for maybe a month. I rest up after I fight normally. Mm-hmm. And what I would do, I would box a lot of different guys that probably couldn't hurt me or nothing like that.
Okay.
And I would slowly work on my timing, rolling my shoulders, mm-hmm. and stuff like that. And then once I got in shape, I always asked Milton McCoy to box me.
Okay.
Because I knew he'd come in there, he ain't going to play, he going to try to hurt me or whatever he going to do. And that's what I wanted from him. And that's how I know I was ready for the fight. If he can't hit me or do nothing to me, I'm ready to fight. Mm-hmm. So that was real key for me with him.
Oh, we got another call.
One time, Manny Stewart stopped the workout because me and him was throwing punches. And he said, oh, somebody's going to get knocked out. He stopped the workout.
We got another call. The caller, you on the air. Caller, you on the air.
Hello?
You on the air.
Hello.
Hello, what's going on?
Hey, Jimmy. Jimmy Paul.
Yeah.
He can hear you.
Is Jimmy Paul?
Yes, yeah. Jimmy Paul.
Remember when I was in the ring with you, man?
What is it?
Can you
hear him? Is it Jimmy Paul or Mark?
Yeah, that's right.
We were sparring. I knocked you out.
Does he knock you out?
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, it was
I never me. Got, to be talking about that, I never got knocked down in the gym ever in my life.
Okay, Ron Banks was the referee.
Who you say?
Ron Banks.
Ron Banks?
Yeah, the singer, Ron Banks.
No.
R.J. Watkins, buddy.
Well, oh, it's Robert.
It's R.J. Watkins.
Oh, that's Robert.
That's R.J. Watkins.
That's R.J. Watkins.
All right.
You had him scared for a minute.
Right.
Say what, man?
You had him scared for a minute. He had to think back.
I don't know, Robert.
Jimmy, Jimmy knocked me out almost, man.
Now, I enjoy going over there swimming over there at your house in the back. He had a nice pool over there.
Hey, Jimmy, yeah. I leave the number for me, man, with my engineer. I got to talk to you, man.
Okay.
We got some things happening.
All right.
Okay. All right, Mr. RJ.
Yeah. Good show, man. Take it easy.
All right.
That was nice.
Yeah.
It startled Jimmy. Knocked me out. What?
Yeah.
No.
What up, though?
I got a, you've been saying my name wrong the whole time. It's Jabu, not Jabu.
Uh-oh. See, that's why I told y'all. I always give people names. That's why I say y'all say y'all names.
Yeah,
I've been calling you that for a while. You saw
always
saying this. Let me tell you something about. Let me tell y'all something about Jabu, okay? We be at the Golden Gloves. I be messing with him. Yeah. I say, okay, we do our little bets or whatever like that. You know, we ain't going to say what we bet on.
Right,
but
right.
My man Jabu, man, I like him, man. He hilarious, man.
I'm always
interesting, man. And he ain't. He is not scared to fight. I swear he ain't. I put it on. I didn't heard this man say, I can't wait till he got out the ring. I'm getting the ring, and I'm going to beat his ass. That's what I'm saying. Just like that. Yeah. Hey, you need a fighter like that. But I appreciate Duck. Duckhead got on you at the Golden Gloves. Yeah. Man, we got another caller. Let's get these callers calling in, boy.
Ask J. Boo, what's his full name? Because he's only giving part of it. Ask him his full name.
Thank you for calling in, okay?
Hello.
Just call back because my phone line is blowing up. I ain't never had this many calls. But so, quick question. Did y'all play basketball a lot during y'all time? Like, after, before y'all go to the gym? Get ready to train? Did y'all play basketball with each other a lot?
I wanted to play basketball in high school, but, you know, I had to be at training at about maybe 4 o'clock. So I had to miss all the functions they had. I would never hardly go to them. I barely went to maybe 2 a year.
Well, when I played basketball, it was street ball, and they didn't like me to play. They called me Dennis Rodman because I fouled. I fouled you quick. I stopped you from making it. So
Erskine, where did you grow up at? Like in Detroit? Like was you coming up? Did you grow? Because Jim, you grew up on East Side, right?
Yes.
Where did you grow up?
Well,
at?
I'm actually from Chicago.
You
I was born and raised in Chicago.
I can't tell.
Yes, sir. I graduated at 17 years of age, and I moved here with my parents.
Okay.
Because, you know, the jobs and so forth, whatever, and did my thing.
Now, you also got a son that boxed. You also had a brother, Danny Paul, that boxed. So
yep.
They said Danny. Ooh, it's a Danny one to play with.
Yeah, a lot of time, people wouldn't even box him. I would have to
I
box
was
him
one.
Because
I wouldn't box him.
Not out of shape.
Yeah.
Not in shape either.
Why not?
Man, that boy was a beast. Yeah.
He made me say I got a lot better because I boxed him anyway. Mm-hmm. He was too big and too strong. I mean,
he was
bigger than
me.
He run you from rope to rope, but you got to think real quick to get around him.
Yes.
What about your nephew Cedric boxed, right? He boxed.
Very talented.
Yeah. Okay, yeah, right.
For a short time, yes.
Yeah.
So, Jay Boo, when you fighting again, man?
I don't know. I think it's a show on March 22nd.
You get ready for that Golden Gloves?
Of course.
So, is this your last Golden Gloves, or are you going to wait?
I think this is my
because, you know, it's here in Detroit, so.
Oh, man, that's a dream.
That's a big one. You know, you got the NFL draft, too. You going to go down there in line and say you're going for the Lions? You going to dress up?
Well, there's one thing about it I can say. I stand tall on this. J. Boo is the best 156-pounder in the state of Michigan.
Okay.
Believe that. J. Boo would beat every kid. I mean, most of every 156-pounder he didn't beat. He didn't demolish. Now, we might be going down to 147, so we can make some noise.
Well, you know who's at 147, correct?
Oh, yeah. I know them all.
Quite a few.
Right.
I don't got nothing to worry about down there. Nah.
Okay. Can you make it to 147?
I actually can. You know, if I put my mind to anything, I can do it.
Okay.
I won every Golden Glove I've been to. Then I went to the Nationals, lost in the finals. I want to run that back. I'm going to run that back. I'm going to win.
Well, it's here in the city.
This year.
So you got nothing. It's right here in the city. But let me say what earlier. And this one makes me know that Duck is is not a good coach, but he's a great coach by eye. Because it was a fight that you fought that you should have stopped, and you didn't. And when you got out the ring, he cussed you out from all the way from the ring all the way to the back. And that's needed in boxing. Because, you know, if you can get the guy out of there, get him out of there. Why are you starving? Erskine was so – you won, but he was so mad. And I was like, dang, why are you mad? But then I heard him like, no, I ain't trying to hear that. You should stop the guy. Yeah. But I see why he do that. Now, a lot of coaches, because a lot of these guys, they just want to come. Because, Jim, you had a gym over there. Man, Jimmy Paul had one of the best gyms.
Yes, he still got some misfits.
Yeah, boy.
It's definitely a
7 Mile in Buffalo.
Yeah.
You had to be there 5 days a week. He had work for everybody. Mm-hmm. Everybody had boxing.
True.
So he has some killers over there.
Nice fighters.
Nice fighters. Yes. So, Jimmy Jim, was the best out at that time.
One of his fighters is still at large. What's his name? Thomas
Covington.
Thomas Covington, yes.
He had a lust.
That boy's sweet.
And he still can fight.
That boy's
Jimmy
sweet.
Taught him well. Jimmy taught him well.
But yeah, on the subject of Duck, it's definitely a push. And he know how to get it out of me. He seen me do better. He seen me stop better fighters. You know, I was in there having fun, but, you know, it's not a game. So he was like, you could have stopped him. And I wobbled him. I got the eight count. It was time to apply pressure, and I did. So,
now, was you trying to just have fun in there, or were you just...
Well, I knew I was winning, so I had got, like, relaxed. And I was like, all right, I'm going to just have my fun and coast.
Okay.
But Duck was like, you got to put a finish on these boys. Like,
send a message.
It's never a time where you're supposed to take your foot off the gas. Whether you got them two rounds or three rounds, it don't matter.
And, based on what he just said, that happened to me one time in a fight. I was got into a fight, an amateur fight, years ago. Maybe I had about 10, 12 fights at this particular time.
Okay.
And instead of jumping on the guy, finishing him, knocking him out, I was boxing and fooling around with the guy.
Okay.
And I lost the fight. And after that, I said I would always respect the opponent. I don't care what's going on with him. I respect anything about him because that's how you need to go into any fight. So I never did that again after that.
Okay.
Yeah.
One thing about it, I was kind of upset. I forgot to tell you this part here. You know, a friend of mine, a sparring partner, I used to box with him all the time, and I said, well, I'm going to get you in shape. You getting ready to fight Jimmy Paul. And it was Alvin Two Sweet Hayes. And I was like, Alvin, you
somebody
ready?
Somebody had Jimmy knocked out.
And Jimmy knocked him out. It hurt me so bad, you know, because I was getting him in shape for the fight.
Jimmy always doing something.
Jimmy is dangerous.
Well, they called me for the fight.
Oh, they did?
Yes, they called me and said it wasn't nobody in Las Vegas for him to fight. He was fighting on the card with Thomas Hearns and Roberto Duran, I believe.
Okay.
Yeah.
And so he said they were going to be the co-main event. So what happened then, when they scheduled me and him to fight, I saw him out. I saw somebody out at Palmer Park. They parked their car on my back of my bumper, all the way up on it. And I went around to run. When I got back around, they was running, and I saw that it was his car. So maybe a week or two later, I'm running the whole Belle Isle. And I pull up outside of Belle Isle, and I see his car out there. So you know where I parked at. Right on his bumper. We get to Las Vegas, he just going nuts on me, chasing me all down the strip, him and four or five guys. And it was something else, man. I mean, I went through a lot in that fight.
So you had to make sure you knocked him out.
Well, if I didn't knock him out, I said to myself, I'm going to quit boxing because there's no way I can come back behind that.
Yeah. Well, yeah. I had a story.
Yeah.
That I heard Emmanuel cussed you out because you wouldn't throw that right hand straight. So you didn't box for months.
That did happen. Yes, it did.
You didn't throw that right hand straight, so he had you didn't box for months.
Oh, my goodness. He wouldn't let me fight or nothing. I'm going to all these fights and watching these guys fight, but I was slapped with my right hand. But after he wouldn't let me fight for so long, I had one of the best right hands in the whole organization. After I started knocking, I had like probably about 16 straight knockouts when I turned professional.
Now, would you call yourself a veteran? Because you was very patient. It took you rounds to really get the feeling. Would you say call yourself a very patient fighter?
Of course I'll call myself a patient fighter. That's what I made a lot of the time. Bill Clancy and them guys would always call me Mr. Patience. Because I would take my time and set a fighter up. Instead of just going in, just trading punches, gambling. I can play chess and take him into the deep water and knock him out easier with no problem.
What about you, Duck? Would you call yourself a patient fighter, or you just get ready to go? Like
I was just, I was manipulator. I want to make sure, and that's why I got the name Duck. You can hardly hit me. But somebody finally made the contact, so I got to tell you that much. It was hard to hit me at first, and this one kid named Harold Knight, I fought for the championship.
That's who you beat?
No, that's who beat me.
Oh, okay.
You know, and
who did you beat for the Michigan State
title? That guy trained Lennox Lewis at
J.L. Ivory. Forget the other kid's name.
You said what, Jimmy?
Harold Knight trained Lennox Lewis.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, he ended up with him before Manu.
And I fought him in the Nationals, in the National Apparel Tournament. That's what beat me the second time.
Okay.
In the National Apparel Tournament, in the finals. Okay. I mean, you know, I just make sure that I stayed above. I was a boxer. I was always a guy, and they thought I was a scared fighter, but I was a smart fighter. I didn't want to get hit. You know, I'm a slick. Don't hit me with this. I was Muhammad Ali. You know.
Now, Jay Poo, who did you say got down on you? You like, I can't wait to get back to him on box. He got down on you a little bit. Not a lot, but he got down on you. Like, I can't wait to get this mug.
Talking about like, anybody?
Yep.
Nobody that I remember too bad. Like, I mean, I definitely, like my last fight, well, not my last fight, Keon Davis in the Olympic trial.
Okay.
Most definitely will run that back. I went with a different game plan, you know.
Okay.
I listened to what somebody else said was the key, and really all I had to do was box like me, and I was supposed to fight my own fight. So I feel like I could rerun that. Better.
Mm-hmm.
But so, other than that, nobody really.
Okay. So what makes you stand out different from the other fighters in Michigan? What makes Jay Boo different?
What makes him the great?
There you go. Yep.
Yeah. I feel like it's my hard work. My hard work and my will to win and just be the best. You know, a lot of people get complacent. Like, you see a lot of these dudes, they work a little bit and think they just the baddest man ever. It's always work to be done. It's always more work to be done. And you just got to be a student of the sport. You got to be teachable. Like, a lot of people, once they learn something, they be like, all right, I don't need to learn no more. I'll learn from any coach, any trainer, anybody out here. Wow. It don't matter. You know, that's just, I feel like that's what makes me the great.
So, Jimmy, tell me about when you train fighters. And then I'm going to go to Duck with the same question. So, you kind of, when you train fighters, what's the first thing that you pinpoint on when you coaching a fighter?
Just what they show me. If I see a weakness, I see something they're not doing right, they ain't got their hand in the right position. And sometimes I may let them box with their hands down on purpose.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of people would get on me about it. He's not a pro, he shouldn't fight with
his hands down. Was that something Tommy Rowland showed you? Or?
No, but it's just something I learned. Like I said, I've been in the gym with 50 to 100 world champions on a regular, so I'm looking at everything that's going on. And I want the guys to learn how to move their heads and slip instead of just being a boxer. But now when you fight somebody that can hurt you a little bit, keep your hands up. But I want you to be slick, tricky. I want you to have it all.
What about you, Duck?
Well, my thing is, you know, if you got a fighter and you see anything in them, develop it.
Mm-hmm.
Develop it.
Okay.
You got a good one too. Develop it. If to me, and it's not to hurt anybody's feelings, but that heart, you got to have that heart. That heart takes you a long way. Mm-hmm. Takes you a long way. I give you a perfect example. When I first got Jay Boo, he was 13,
mm-hmm.
and he had no fights, and went to Atlanta, and this kid had 7 fights, mm-hmm. and Jay Boo said, "I'll fight him. I'll take the fight right now." I said, "Nah, I don't want you to fight him." And then he kept on telling me, he said, "I'm gonna beat him. I got him." And he took the fight and he won.
Mm.
So
that's hard.
It let me know that this kid was ready.
It seemed like a lot of fighters abandon the jab. But like, I don't know. I barely see fighters use the jab the way it's supposed to be used.
Ooh, that's the key.
Yeah.
That's the best punch.
And because it can be your offense, defense, and also a setup shot. Yeah. A lot of fighters don't use that for some reason. I don't know why, but maybe that's not for me to answer. You
coach,
they want to get
irritated. You know, you get irritated. Some guys just want to fight. That all that patience and sitting around and filling the guy out and figuring out the proper way to fight him, they don't want to waste no time with that. That's their thinking. They want to just get at him right away and just go to banging.
Mm-hmm.
And you get a guy and use a jab on him, a lot of times they show you all their errors, what's wrong with me.
Right.
They throw their punches the wrong way. You can counter punch and everything because you got that distance between them. A jab is the best punch in boxing.
Okay.
And if you recall, in the Golden Gloves, I had Jay Boo to use the jab the last round,
mm-hmm.
just overwhelming when he fought against,
okay.
Mr.
So would you say, Duck, would you say amateurs is more fun than you did in the professionals?
You say more fun?
Was it more fun? Like, was boxing more fun then than it was in the pros?
Yeah, I mean, it's an amateur thing, so it's going to be fun.
Because you can get some get back right away.
Yeah. But the amateur was nice. I mean, I turned pro and it was a good thing, but I love the amateurs. Going out of town,
traveling,
doing this,
right.
Going there.
Yes. They paid y'all too, right?
No, we didn't get paid.
Y'all didn't get paid per deal money to be out there?
No, not back then.
They did.
They didn't get y'all expense money
when
y'all
was out there? I mean, they fed us.
To eat and stuff like that?
Yeah, I never got no money. You got money?
I got money when we would fight, like, the Russians or something
like that. Yeah, something like that, yeah.
Oh, they didn't get y'all expense money when y'all go to the Olympics?
They feed us, though. They take us to the tournament, feed us.
J-Boo, they don't get y'all money when you go to the tournament?
Now they do.
I have a little bit of money on.
They don't give y'all money to eat out there? I thought they
would
tell
them.
Okay. But they didn't do that with y'all.
No, I didn't.
Dang. I wonder why I was
that. But you know what? He might have made us greater, better fighters, man, because we were hungry.
But, man, you know what? That's crazy. Y'all had to stay on weight for 5 days. That would make it weight, boy.
We were in shape. Yeah. I tell you. Manuel, I fought in the National against, what's the kid name? He was number one, featherweight. And Andy Mister. And, I'm wrong. It wasn't Andy Mister. It was, anyway, Manny jumped in my corner and told me, Duck, what are you doing? You losing the fight. What you doing? The first round. And I went out there like a wild man, threw 1,000 punches each round. And I ended up beating the one in the fight. You know, so you hungry. You ain't thinking about food and this and that. You're going to try to win this championship, you know? And that man just had a way of touching people, man.
So, yeah. Right, before we get out of here, Jimmy, you got to tell us, how was the night when you won the IBF title? How was the night after you won the title? Did you celebrate? Did you go home? I know you got a big, big, beautiful family. So I know that y'all had dinners. How was it?
Well, what I did after the fight, it was in Atlantic City.
Okay.
And we had like a little area in the cafeteria we ate in that night. And okay. It really didn't dawn on me. You know, you got to, after a few days, go by, hey, you champion of the world. Don't just dawn on you right away when you win it. It takes a few days. You come back home and you get introduced in the ring and all kind of stuff going on. And stuff is being built around you. Next thing you know, you got a camp set up and you got your heavy bag with your name on it and whatever else. And everybody got to work behind you now. Hey, I want the speed bag next? I got the speed bag or whatever.
Oh, see, I had to make an appointment.
Was over. So that kind of stuff.
That had to be,
of course,
fun.
Some cash,
back
too.
To y'all day, man. But I'm glad y'all was able to come up here and share that, because to me, I love hearing y'all story, because y'all story is history. Yeah. And a lot of people don't know, hey, y'all came from the mud. A lot of people don't know where y'all came from. And it's crazy that a lot of people don't know about the Detroit history. You know what I'm saying? The history of boxing. You'll be so many people. Probably, you know, a lot of people don't know Milton McCurry is the first Detroit-born fighter, world champion.
Born from Detroit.
Yeah, that's a lot of people that question. They don't know it.
Yeah.
Exactly.
So, you know, it's what you have to learn the history. Not just, you know, of course, Kronk was out there. AI was the more. But when I hear from Duck and hear his story, I like hearing stories like that. Because I visualize it. Dang, I wonder how was it back then. And then you got Jay Boo, somebody's coming up. We get to finally see your story. You get to tell your story. But before we get out of here, starting with you, Jay Boo, how can the people get in touch with you?
On Instagram, Jay Boo the Great. Periods in between. JBoo.the.great.
Okay.
And I want to say one thing. I don't mean to cut you off, but
no, go ahead.
We have a thing at the gym now at Kronk, which is with Escott. We helping kids with homework. We building kids to be more than just boxers. We being able to be people with the society that we have today. We teach them to go and make something happen in their life positive. That's what we're doing
now.
And
that
now
is true. I've been over
not
there.
Not just boxing.
I witnessed that.
But to teach a kid 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 means a lot. To teach a kid D-O-G spelled dog, that means a lot. The gloves are good, but we want the kids to know that we're there for them.
Yep.
Physically,
care
mentally,
about them, right.
Financially.
And y'all do got a great program. I've been over there and witnessed that. But for the people out there listening, how can they get in touch with you, Erskine Wade?
313-425-1999. That's 313-425-1999.
Now, that's your phone number or lottery number?
That's my
phone
number.
Okay. How can they get in touch with Jimmy, the ringmaster, Paul?
Well, you normally I'm into real estate now and
house.
Boxing, of course. They can call down to Kronk and they can get me from there.
Okay. Yep. But before we get out of here, let me see. Look, I got a second left. Well, never mind. I was going to say, how do y'all become so close as friends? But we know that already.
Oh, man.
We'll be
able
to
tell you some stories. We'll be a little a long time.
All right.
Yeah.
Thank y'all for coming in, man. This is FM 88.1 WHPR, the Rerun Detroit Boxing Show. I'm your host, Mr. Laidback Corey. We'd like to thank the Kronk legend. We'd like to thank the Michigan State champion legend. We'd like to thank the future, the truth, Jay Boo. Thank you for coming in, fellas. See y'all next week, Thursday.
All right.
Until then, peace.
I can't wait. This Jay Boo that made